this example and wrap up this case study we started yesterday. We were considering this system where we're trying to optimize two variables, temperature and substrate concentration, and we spent some considerable time looking at how we moved from our baseline over there. We put down the factorial, those four experiments that we moved up to 0.5 and 6 in yesterday's class. And we looked at the profit as we move along that direction. And let's just recap some of the numbers over there to indicate what's going on. Because remember, we're like a blind person trying to move along this the surface, and the only thing we have available to us is a measure of profit, which is our lidar. So we use those confidence values that we get to decide whether we should keep going in the direction, whether we should stop. And today's class is going to teach you how we figure out when to stop. It's not trivial to figure out when you've reached the altitude. The condition is pretty trivial to state in words, but it's hard to actually know for certain because you'll never really know if it's comfortable below it. So this state is a little artificial. We know where to stop because we know the altitude is just right over there. But in reality, we won't know those lines. So how would we know to stop? So let's take a look at what we've done so far on this day. If we recap our baseline, and then 0.5, and then 0.6, we had the profit at our baseline was $407. And our profit at 0.5, and then the profit at 0.6 was $688. So just simply looking at those points, and actually perhaps I should add 0.4 over there, and you're going to see why looking at 0.4 in a minute. 0.4 was $571. The reason why I'm looking at those points is you see there's a progression in the value increasing, and 0.4 is over there, 5 is over there, and 6. So they're not lined up perfectly, but it's indicating just visually there's a rising trend in that direction. And I'd say last class that this slide are a little bit poorly done. In fact, if I was doing this in practice today, I would not implement this as I've shown it to you up here. This was my first attempt at this. In fact, we showed you yesterday's class, even at 0.5, we saw the model start to break down, and at 0.6 especially, the model broke down quite substantially. Remember what's going on here, below us is a surface that's doing this. We're fitting a tangent plane like that. So our prediction of the plane is over there, our actual value is over here, and when that offset gets large, we know our model has broken down. It's time to stop and rebuild our model. So this model over here is good enough in this local region, but beyond a certain point, it breaks down. So at point 5 and 6, let's just recall there our y-hat. So you can see that breakdown. Y-hat at 0.5, our prediction was $764. So we were already off by about $100 at 0.5. At 0.6, our prediction from that slope, straight line slope going up was 1,120. So we're substantially off by 0.6, indicating our model should be rebuilt. So I'm going to rebuild the model at 0.6. But yesterday the question was asked, could we not have rebuilt the model at 0.5? And the answer is absolutely. You can go and build a factorial at 0.5 as well. Let's take that for a minute. 0.5 could be used as starting a new factorial. Where would you put the experiments 6 and 7? And 8 and maybe 9. If you were at 0.5, and these experiments experiments cost a substantial amount of money. They'd say $500,000 per experiment. You had data points 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Where would you choose to spend the next $1 million? So two more experiments.
Low, high, 331, 339. And
that corresponds to minus 1, plus 1, minus 1, plus 1. On the substrate scale, we've got minus, minus, plus, plus. And that would correspond in substrate units. We may choose is a range here of 1.77 for low, and my upper bound is 2.17. slope coefficient so you can do the next plot. V naught, has anyone got a value for V naught? 674.
Above the line over there. So you're getting lines that sort of look like this.
688. 688 is actually corresponds on this vertical axis is also roughly about midway between 640 and 725. 688 happens to be about midway. This is kind of interesting because this shows almost like a straight line here. Then where do we go next? 688 is pretty close to 694. Indicating we've got something that looks like that. There's your first hint that something different is happening here in this factorial. So it's indicating some presence of curvature for us. Let's take a look at this direction. It seems to sense. Visually we can tell there will certainly be somewhere down here. The number 725 tells us that. So we know that we're going to be heading in this sort of direction. Well, exactly what direction is that? Anyone calculate what delta xs is going to be? Okay. Minus 3. Everyone got minus 3? Yeah. Let's take a look at how I've got that. So the rule is delta xs over delta xt is equal to the slope coefficient of s divided by the slope coefficient of t, which is minus 39 over 13, which is minus 3. So delta xs is equal to minus 3 times plus 1, and then we're making a delta xt change of plus 1 of xt. So delta xs then is equal to minus 3. What is t12? Sorry, let's ask before we calculate t12, what is delta t12, delta t I should say, and delta s in real world units?
Calculated that, would you believe your answer? How can you check?
but we don't know the true value yet. So we haven't run the experiment yet. Does 810 look reasonable? Yes, it does, because it's an increase over our highest value of 725. So there's 688, there's 725. We're down here somewhere, 810 looks pretty reasonable. Always double check your answers so that you don't make calculation errors. When we run our actual experiment, we get the Y12 of 716 volts. So let's take a look at where we are on this plot. Our new data point is over here. And we get a value of 712. How would you update those contour lines now with that new data point? That's the actual value. If you run the experiment, you get that number. 716. So 716, how do you incorporate that new data point in the contour line? Okay, so 694 is there. 694 is going to be somewhere over here. 725 is over there, 716. 725, 716, those numbers are roughly the same. They should lie on the same contour line, indicating you've got something like this happening. This is where I'm saying you're the blind person walking around. You're the blind person, that's immediately what you can start building up in your head. Not done any extra work, you're simply using these six or seven data points that you have now available to you. You spend a lot of money getting these data points. You want to build the best possible model you can of the surface. 725, 716, they're going to lie roughly on the same contour line. There's 688, 694. Project that around. You're starting to build this mental picture up. Now you can see why the model broke down. You predicted 810, you got a value of 760, that's $100 off. Right? You established yesterday, that's a fairly large error. What do you notice about those lines? They're significantly non-linear. A least squares model is a linear model. There's no linear terms in our model. We've got y is equal to an intercept plus btst plus bs times xs plus bts. There's your two factors, right? There is some non-linearity here, but this coefficient is very small. Our contour lines here, however, indicate substantial non-linearity. Think of the substrate direction. Visually, what is the contour, what is the profile in this vertical direction look like? You cut through those contours, you looked at it on the side, what would you see? So you start over here, and you moved along this vertical line, what sort of terrain would you cross? Okay, so as you're going either down or up, you're climbing the mountain, and you're climbing back down again. What does that indicate? What sort of shape is that?
Parabolic.
You know this in high school, it's parabolic. Right? So you've got a shape that looks like that. You've got a data point here, here, and here. What sort of model terms do you need to fit that shape? You need a quadratic. Okay? So we need to improve our model to add that new information. We want to model now that y is p naught plus temperature plus the slope coefficient for substrate. But now we're going to want for sure for bt. That's your existing model. We want to add a little bit more to it. We want to add some quadratic terms. We can add two quadratic terms, btt xt squared BSS exit swing. This is definitely going to be a significant coefficient. The quadratic coefficient to substrate absolutely will be significant. So in order to have a model that captures nonlinearity, you need the nonlinear terms that we expect. So in order to have a model that captures that nonlinearity, you need to capture the effect of the quadratic, you need at least three data points. We know that. That's the minimum requirement if you want to fit a quadratic equation, you need three data points. So what we're going to do here, we're going to take our base model, and you look at it purely from this perspective where you've got xt and xs in a vertical direction, horizontal direction. We've only got two data points in each direction. So if we want to add nonlinear terms that captures quadratic effects, we better add points that will add to that line. And now you've got several choices here. We could obviously add a data point there and there. Now you've got three points in a row for the xt quadratic effect. You can add a point there and there for the xs. So from the xs perspective, you've got three data points. Xt's perspective, you've got three data points. That's certainly one way of doing it. There is a more statistically efficient location for those data points. And that's shown on the slides one over. So if you look ahead in the notes, you'll see that we add what are called axial data points. These points sit over here, 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 and here. And the distance from the center to those tips of the axial points has a certain ratio. We call that ratio alpha, this distance from the center point is a distance alpha, and that alpha is the root 2, if you've got a two-factor system. Okay, so this is what's called the central composite design. We changed our design for a full factorial, and we go add these four extra experimental data points at those axial locations. We use these points rather than the ones I showed you originally is that the axial design has a property that we call rotatability. You can look at this design from any angle, you can rotate it, and the distance of those additional points are equally far away from the center. Yes? So 1.4. It's a number that's being pre-calculated for us as being the most efficient location to place those axial data points. Okay, so what this says to us is we're going to take our base factorial, we've already done those four experiments plus the center point. Let's go add four more experiments to go enhance our knowledge of the system so that we can go add two more slope coefficients. So we want to go add two more quadratic terms so that that model becomes a more accurate representation of the terrain or the slopes below us. So below us, we know that we've got this curvature being set up. In order to capture that curvature accurately with the model, we need to add these additional slope coefficients. So let's go take a look at that. So we'll do those four extra experiments. What is the location of this data point over here in coded units? What is its temperature value in coded units? If I go back to this coordinate system, it would be as if I was placing this point over there, there, there. So the diagram is becoming a little bit messy. So what is this location in coded units for temperature? Zero. What's it for substrate? Minus 1.4. So substrate coefficients at this location? 0 temperature, plus 1.4. They added 2-4 naturally. So now when we set up our X matrix, we're adding 4 extra rows. Those 4 extra rows are long experiments 13, 14, 15, and 16. So Y6, 8, 9, 10, 11, those were the center point and the 4 corner points we had originally. We add 4 new experiments, 13, 14, 15, and 16. And we add 2 new coefficients, BTT and BSS, on at the end. So we built that quadratic model. Now, this is not something that you can start to do by hand. It should be showing you the X matrix. But let's take a look at what this would be in R. So let's work through what we've done. Everything now, I'm going to show you how you could have done in R. So in R, you would go, let's go back to that factorial at points number 6, plus the 4 points around it. So again, this code is posted on the website. You don't need to copy it down. And we can go build a model here, and if you type summary.model, there's my model. So you guys calculated your intercept 674, the temperature slope coefficient was 13 minus 39, and there's your small two-factor extraction. So you've done that. There's also some code to help you visualize the surface. So we looked at this last time. Let's go visualize the surface. Copy and paste that code in, and let's just zoom that up for you, so you can see what it looks like. So notice my new frame of reference is 0, 0. That's experiment 6 in the middle over there. And there's my other 4 around it, and the direction of steepest descent is definitely in this direction that we calculated. There you go. Place your experiment 12, and you predicted a profit of about 800 and some dollars, but when you go run the actual experiment, you've got a lower profit value. So then you decide to go add your central composite points. So this code up here shows how you do that. There's your 5 original data points. Now you go add the 0, square root 2, 0, minus square root 2. There's the same coefficient for S, and there's the 4 corresponding values for when you go build that model again, now you change your model, you add 2 new terms, you add a quadratic for S and a quadratic for T. So let's take a look at that model. And down here we can see this. There's my intercept now, 690. It's telling me the profit I expect when I have at the 0, 0 points at 688, and in fact, we had a value over there of 688. You don't see it anymore, it's been written over several times, but in fact, that corresponds exactly with the profit that I got there earlier on, so that looks good. This model tells me, take a look at the temperature and substrate coefficients. Very similar to what they were before. Increase temperature, decrease substrate. But here we can now see a very significant substrate coefficient, minus 12. The 2 stars next to it tell me that the confidence interval on that is significant. IT squared tells me the coefficient, or T squared is quadratic effect, very barely significant coefficient, and then that one is not significant. Now, what I want you to take away from this is that this point in the modeling, you cannot go and find the direction of steepest descent from this model. Because it's such a complex quadratic model, the only thing that you can do now at this point is go find your next experiment. So remember we've done experiment 12 down there. That experiment 12 wasn't wasted, but it established to us that we had significant curvature. Then we ran 13, 14, 15, 16. The question you need to ask yourself now is still not at the optimum, but where do I put experiment 17? How do you figure out where to put 17? objective still is the same. How do we get to an answer?
Those are the two numbers you go tell your operators to go move the process to.
or the laboratory system, or whatever it is that you're working on.
What's white hat 17?
Somewhere between 7:30, 7:50. So here's the final solution, and it's sharing your notes. So there's 3.3, 1.57 grams per liter. Your predicted value, if you go use the model, is 7.36. Your actual value when you run the experiment there is 7.38. So you're pretty much spot on. So notice here what I've done, I've just shown you here in red. Red is the circular contours from the model, from that central composite design with the axial points. It's a little bit offset from the true optimum which is over there. So there's 7.38, you've landed up over there at 7.36. So you're not far off. Remember, the models are not 100% accurate. Okay, now we've covered this, and that's the end. I still didn't quite get to one important point. How do you know you are actually at the optimum? I've shown you you're at the optimum. How do you know you're at the optimum? What's special about the optimum? Any other point you move into is going to be lower. That's the definition of optimum. When you try to minimize, every point around is going to be higher. Here's another point I want you to think about over the weekend. What are you going to do if one of these variables here, say on the horizontal axis, is a categorical? Okay, let's talk on Monday.